Hello, my name is Janet Pierce. I'm an ESL teacher and English Language Learner Coordinator at Franklin Regional School District in Murrysville, Pennsylvania. I've been teaching ESL for over 20 years, and in that time period, I've taught in classrooms, closets, boiler rooms, basements, and other teachers' classrooms, as well as regularly sized classrooms. These experiences demonstrated that place and space greatly impact interaction and instruction in ESL classrooms. I also experienced power constructs that shape the designation of places and spaces for instruction. Today I would like to talk about my article in the TESOL Electronic Journal, Volume 16, titled Using Geosemiotic Analysis to Explore Power and Interaction in the ESL Classroom. I would like to thank you, Jarvis, for the gracious invitation to participate in this video discussing that article. My article is based upon a study I did for my dissertation in 2009. My article talks about the need to shift the traditional paradigm of studying discourse and interaction to the ecological paradigm, expanding discourse analysis to include components of Skolin and Skolin's geosemiotic analysis framework that allows multifaceted data collection. For my study, I researched school districts with demographics similar to my own so that the findings might inform my own instruction. As a result, I was examining three different ESL classes in two different school districts over a seven-month period that had multiple English language learners of various cultures and language backgrounds of different language proficiencies and different grade levels in the same ESL classes. In my study, my geosemiotic analysis framework utilized three elements: ESL teachers, English language learners, and the material and classroom design. Additionally, I combined three different perspectives: cultural geography, sociocognitive, and sociocultural perspectives through the use of Skolin and Skolin's geosemiotic analysis framework, which examines the crossings of different people's cultures, their signs, and meaning making. A key construct of Crane's cultural geography is that culture is contained in real-life situations in temporally and spatially defined ways. Cultural geography examines the materials and ideas of a culture in order to see how cultures make meaning of space, to see how they use the semiotic systems important to their culture for meaning making. Crane and Bourdieu talk about cultures being political and contested. So in my study, I wanted to see if and how the various cultures and power constructs of ELLs, the ESL teachers, the school districts, all impacted instruction in the ESL classroom. For instance, Crane talks about spaces structuring cultures by the way people enact their lives with the materials that are important to that particular culture. For instance, in the United States classroom culture, the type of desks, books, and materials a student uses in the social studies classroom is totally different from the materials that would be used in the science class. And each culture represented in the school has different perceptions of how to use these different materials in the various classrooms. On the other hand, Atkinson's sociocognitive perspective supports conversation as being jointly constructed among those speaking and the topic of conversation in order to produce meaning for that individual. Therefore, meaning comes from the way a person understands and uses a society's products, practices, and tools, which in my study was the ESL classroom materials. In contrast, a sociocultural perspective considers literacy and communicative events in the interactive context of others from an emic perspective within specific communities. So, I used three components of Skolin and Skolin's geosemiotic analysis framework. I used Goffman's 1971 interaction order, Kress and Van Leeuwen's 1996 visual semiotics, and Skolin and Skolin's 2003 place semiotics in order to examine how spoken, written, visual discourse portrayed by the interaction of people, place, objects, tools, and culture and literacy practices in the ESL classroom took place over a specific period of time. In this article, I discuss the consequences of the interaction to show how geosemiotic analysis provides multifaceted data collection that explores power and interaction in those classrooms. I examined my discourse analysis through a geosemiotic analysis framework because it offered a way to study the ESL classroom discourse as a social and ecological totality, considering the power and interaction in the ESL classrooms. Data collection included participant observations, field notes, transcribed audio recorded conversations, photographs of interaction between the ESL teachers, the L's, and the materials used in various places in the ESL classroom, as well as member-checked data from the photographs of the interaction and from the journals kept by the ESL teacher and the L's. Since I worked with minors, I had to get consent to participate and photograph forms signed from the students and their parents. Additionally, I interviewed the principals at each school district site. I used these administrative interviews to understand the urban plan a school district and uses and their allocation of materials and space for the ESL teacher. Now, these interviews provided the first evidence that there are indeed power constructs, starting at the administrative level, as to how rooms and materials are allocated. I interviewed the ESL teacher and the L's as to their perceptions of classroom use at the beginning of the study and at the end to see if their perceptions have changed or not. I combined all the data to provide an in-depth analysis of the interaction of the participants with the classroom design or materials and material use. Now, the first geosemiotic components I used was Goffman's interaction order. In my study, I looked at how people show their involvement alone as a single or with others in a with and with materials through the way in which they use body gloss or body movement, how they move around a room, use materials or markers, and present themselves to others through the use of these items and their placement embodiment. The way in which a person does activities or actions one at a time, monochronism, or through multitasking, polychronism, reveals how participants work and portrays information about how they work with others using the materials at hand at specific tasks, their activity involvement. Activities like platform events, presenting materials to others on a stage and in the front of a classroom, and the type of attention accorded to others to include them, civil attention or not, civil inattention, can denote how participants do people processing or gatekeeping encounters. When I combine these components with what is seen in the sign system established within a classroom and in the photographs I took of the classroom, the semiotic aggregate of the ESL classroom comes into focus. For the purposes of my study, the semiotic aggregate is a place where specific discourses are enacted at specific times. Next, the visual semiotics is the materials and the photographs of the interaction of the participants with the materials and each other in the classroom. This includes their eye and body vectors, which show where a person's focused, their body movement, how and where the participants move around the room, information and material modality and salience, how participants perceive materials and information around the room and attribute importance to it, as well as materials indexicality, in other words, where it's referencing, inscription, what it's written with and upon, and code preference, how information is delivered in that semiotic sign system. Taking the concepts of the interaction order and the visual semiotics and locating them in a specific time and place leads to the next component of the geosemiotic analysis of an ESL classroom aggregate, place semiotics. Now, place semiotics facilitates understanding how administrative decisions for the ESL class, the staff, the material designation impact other considerations in the classroom design. Place semiotics includes examining the classroom design through the components of discourse in time and space, in other words, how discourse develops over time in the various places and spaces in an ESL classroom, what code preference students use in journals, homework, and classwork, the emplacement of materials in the ensuing discourse, how participants use their bodies, items, perceptual spaces, and personal distances to create social performances and personal fronts to others in the classroom, as well as the impact of item indexicality and placement upon the discourse and interaction in that classroom. As I collected my data, I searched for components that would help explain the power constructs, the discourse, and the interaction that developed in each ESL classroom. Now, as I stated earlier, there were two sites in my study, Site A and Site B. Site A involved one ESL class, and that was about 60 minutes long each day. And then Site B included two classes of 40 to 45 minutes in length. Site A was a high school, and Site B was a junior high. Within each class, there were a number of participants that varied throughout the school year. For instance, at Site A, a boy that I called Yo was in the class at the beginning, but only sporadically at the end. Site B had the greater changes, especially period 8, with students coming in and out of the class throughout the year. Now, as far as the names that you'll hear in these studies, students had a choice. They could pick their pen name, or they asked me to give them a pen name. So you'll hear different ones throughout this. Now I'll share the findings from my study. There are more details in the article itself. I found that power constructs were made visible. Through a comparison of the data from my interview with the principal, KW, at Site A at the beginning of the year, and then a subsequent email from the teacher over the following summer when that principal had left the school district and a new principal had come, I learned that his esteem for Ms. K, calling her the ESL guru, had led him to allocate a room for Ms. K for many years. When he left and the new principal came, this principal did not accord Ms. K the same esteem, and she lost her power, her room, and her way of working with L's was drastically changed. At Site B, the overarching need to provide instruction for L's and the relative newness of the principal at the junior high gave Ms. M some power to ask for another teacher to meet the needs of all the students who entered halfway through the year. This changed class population and the interaction process. I found that student population, classroom size, and allocation of materials also impacted instruction. At Site A, Ms. K had to have extra desks in her room for her homeroom. This limited how she could arrange her desks because her room was very small. At the same time, her view of herself as the teacher working one-on-one with students to answer and meet all their needs worked. As a result, Site A also had fewer platform events, and the way that the students viewed themselves and Ms. K was different from the way the students at Site B viewed themselves in relationship with the other students and the room and the material use. I also found that data collection at Site A displayed within the geosemiotic aggregate showed how recursive and the interaction was, with the three components of the analysis supporting each other and what was recorded in many different ways. Thus, at Site A, Lou, one of the students, titled as the computer queen, is linked to her use and proximity to the computer she uses in class. Journal writings, photographs, and transcripts corroborated that idea. The one platform event in my study at Site A showed how Lou interacted with the others in the class as the more proficient speaker, clearly comfortable speaking and asking questions in that classroom. Yo showed his proficiency in an indirect way as he maintained a larger distance from the teacher, rarely coming to Ms. K's desk for help. JD, another student, facilitated around the room, working with Ms. K at times and helping others, a role that she clearly sought throughout the year. In this picture here, you can see that this shows what happens when Ms. K decides to focus on teaching two how to create and use PowerPoint presentations. Now, two came from a culture that didn't have much technology, so she didn't know how to use and create PowerPoint. So Ms. K felt that this would be an instructional moment. In this instance, you can see that Lou is accorded civil inattention through gatekeeping and people processing. Ms. K uses this in order to keep her focus on two and keep Lou in the background. The teacher is seated next to two, with J.D. standing looking over Miss K's shoulder, and Lou is sitting behind everyone with her head tilted down. Comparing data from multiple sources allowed me to hear what Lou felt in that situation that I've described. Transcript analysis showed that instances of civil inattention accorded to Lou brought about an answering response of sarcasm.
Oh, yeah.
When Lou felt she was being excluded, as you could see in that picture. In that picture that I showed you and in this next picture, the photographs of items and their placement behind Miss K's desk or on the shelves above the computers in the room supported how Miss K viewed herself as a mother figure and fount of wisdom with numerous resources at her fingertips to help her students. The picture shows Yo's maintenance of personal distance and Miss K's personal front as the fount of wisdom and mother figure. You can also see how Miss K's use of personal items given to her from former L's are used to show her as a caring teacher to the new students that she has at this time. At Site B, however, power constructs revealed Miss K or Miss M has some power by the way in which the principal states in his interview that he hasn't changed the room allotment from what he set aside for the previous ESL teacher, since he's new to the district and he recognizes the wisdom of letting the ESL teacher have a space of her own to meet the needs of their growing number of L's. At this site, it's not necessarily Miss M's expertise, but the growing population and the newness of the principal which dictate and shape power. What the teacher sees as the role of a teacher also differs slightly from Miss M's or Miss K's view of herself as the ESL teacher. Early in the study, Miss M described herself as a facilitator in her journal. Key considerations for classroom design were so that the L's can move around to access materials, be able to see her, the board, the materials they're using, and each other. She also felt it important that the L's understand what they're learning and why they're learning it. To this end, she wrote daily and later weekly objectives for her class on the board in different colors. This inscription and both her perceptions and the L's differed widely at times. The modality key for students was temporal need and customs, not color modality, for student recognition of what was written on the whiteboards. L's looked at the board when they felt they needed to or established patterns of classwork made it prudent to read what was written. All teachers, Miss K at Site A and Miss M and Miss S at Site B, felt their room had limitations. In her journal, and evidenced in the photographs of the study, which recorded the concept, Miss M stressed the need to see the room as having no walls so students can access information and materials in the room and outside the room. The issue of material indexicality was interesting because this influenced how she presented materials within the room, changing bookcases and desks around, changing TVs when their actions, availability, and working condition did not suit her instructional needs. In three instances, this impacted the classroom design. First, at the beginning of the year, her traveling bookcase, as I called it, was located beneath a bulletin board that showcased the students' work. She wanted the students to move to get the materials that they used in class and take it back to their seats. Later, she moved the bookcase closer to the desks, near the front of the room. And then at the end of the year, she moved it back to the other side of the room when she was not using the bookcase materials as much. Additionally, desks were moved around according to the use of materials and according to teacher perceptions of self. Thus, desks were facing the front whiteboard for the most part, but with their arrangement in different styles, depending on what the class activity was. If they were working on their invitation and holiday cards while watching television, they were in rows, so the students could move to get their materials that they needed for their cards while watching television at the back of the room. Later, when that TV no longer worked, students faced the front with a portable TV. Once, Miss M arranged the desks in an inverted U, so she could walk between the two longer prongs of the U-shaped desk arrangement to help different students as they worked. When she realized that she would have her back bent over, facing away from some of the students, she quickly changed that arrangement. Student perceptions of how they worked and the materials they used were evidenced in their journal writings, as each student inscribed journals in different ways. And here you can see that. marking their territory and space through where they wrote, how they wrote, and what they said, orally and in writing. When Draco's star entered the Period 8 ESL class at Site B near the end of the year, he claimed his own identity with his pen name, Draco Star, and blazed over RS, another former L, her journal, minus her writing that had been taken out. In comparison, David became known as the storyteller, in my mind, as he told what he did in the ESL class through stories and illustrations, always inviting me to come into the class and see things for myself. So you can see these journal inscriptions and code preferences in the two pictures. The multifaceted data collection allowed me to glimpse more fully how the students felt about themselves, others, their learning, and their surroundings. Here in the next picture, you can see RS. At Site B, RS never became one with the group. Her lack of language proficiency necessitated moving from one class to another. This photograph shows her standing off by herself in a corner of the room, using her translator to figure out something, working as a single. Her isolation is evident in her personal distance to others in that picture. In the photos and my observation, I found that the classroom design had a definite impact on how students moved around the room at Site A in comparison to Site B. There were people processing and gatekeeping encounters at both sites, but the teachers at Site B had to deal with how to control and interact with students sooner than at Site A. This was due in part to the ALT population, the teaching style, and the activities. The embodiment of discourse was evident sooner at Site B than A as well. Code preference in journals was definitely an issue at Site B, but never at Site A. Was this due to the students' personalities or age? As I mentioned earlier, students at Site B were mostly younger students, still seeking their identity. Social performance in platform events and during the classroom interaction showed how participants used body gloss and body language to portray their personal front as well. For example, at Site B, Jim moved around the room to sharpen his pencil to sign out to go get a drink, while RS and HL stood off by themselves to work as singles. All of these examples are social performances distributed over time and space in the ESL classroom. In conclusion, my geosemiotic analysis showed that the ESL teachers and ELLs used the ESL classroom as an ecological totality, so that the materials in the room help structure the interactions that take place within it in a recursive manner. Thus, the dialogic interaction causes change in the room design at, say, Site B, and change in the relationships and activities enacted in the ESL classroom over time in both sites. Additionally, in my article, which I hope you'll read, this study has implications for pedagogy and TESOL. For instance, two of the many implications I cited for pedagogy include knowing that it underscores the need for teachers to be aware of how they teach best, how to use the materials they do have and the space they've been given, in ways that it support their vision of instruction and enhance second language learning, regardless of cultural differences. It's important to educate teachers so they're cognizant that their classroom design impacts their instruction and the ways the students see themselves as teachers, as a teacher. Awareness of multiple ways to teach and use materials will facilitate second language learning by providing more ways for ELLs to comprehend, practice, and learn meaningful English and feel comfortable learning English. When ESL teachers understand how surroundings situate literacy practices and cause a dialogic interaction they can take into consideration in their classroom design, like Ms. M did, as she moved this and the traveling bookcase around the room. A part of understanding the ESL classroom totality is knowing what the ESL teacher envisions as their role as a teacher. Ms. K's limited room space and subsequent room design fell in accord with her vision of herself as a mother figure, providing wisdom and information to ELLs on an individual basis. Her low numbers supported that role. Ms. M's concept of herself as a facilitator was with a plethora of materials that she can move around, trying to keep her room and the learning student-centered, was supported by the way the students themselves viewed the room as full of stuff. Both room designs and roles as teachers offer exemplars for other districts to consider. For TESOL, it's important to note that there are indeed power constructs within a school district that have far-reaching consequences. Room assignments change, as do the roles of the ESL teacher and the ways they work with the students. In regards to second language acquisition theory, two of the many implications I found were that seating choice and room design impact how L's choose where to sit, what items to use, and how they feel about their actions, which may help teachers learn how to create that lower affective filter to make learning more comfortable. Knowledge of how personal distance and body gloss are used by L's and the ESL teacher may help the ESL teacher better understand that body language is cultural and may differ according to the L and the L's culture, impacting how others perceive what the L may present through body gloss and marker use. Finally, I found that ESL classrooms I studied and in which I work are habitus that exert power and control, as Bourdieu describes. How the ESL teacher unpacks her bag of second language acquisition and second language teaching theory and embraces her room design can make a world of difference to the L's who enter into that space which structures cultures. The iconography of places in education, including the way the educational culture of our time gives import to the signs and markers of a school, does indeed impact each L's learning English in a dialogic recursive manner. Thus, this research demonstrates how completely situated an ESL classroom instruction is within a school district. Thank you.